The meeting minutes of the Collegiate Board for the School of Ethnographic and Tactical Studies show an unusual breakdown in oversight surrounding the approved expedition of recently promoted Adjunct Professor Jean Archibus. The expedition approval was expedited citing concerns regarding territorial disputes with the Empire of Promise, but that should not be grounds for rash acquisitions, and the acquisitions the young professor made are, indeed, quite rash. A collected example. 1 month's ration for 100 researchers. Beds and tents for the same. A contingent of 20 Croxabor and appropriate harness. Weight, necessary to procure the service of 20 Cragsmith mercenaries. Saltpeter, firewort, lightning seed, and wind catalyst, each 1 ton. A carved moon bed, walkwood. 1 throne, gold. It is the belief of this reviewer that Adjunct Professor Archibus is not pursuing the rumors of this precursor city with the proper academic rigor. It is the recommendation of the Academic Oversight and Military Spending Committee that we dispatch a messenger immediately to recall her before she reaches her destinations in the Verdwood. Welcome to the Crooked Thimble, where like minds meet. Today, we continue our adventures in Iron Immortals, the shared setting between this tabletop game, the video game in development at the Crooked Thimble, and my latest novel, 7 Days a Servant, which is currently available for pre-orders on Inkshares. This game is being conducted using a hacked version of the Dungeon World system by Sage Latora and Adam Coble. Our heroes sit at the dinner table in the fortress manor of Harris Reka. They are the guests of Baron Nyland, and she has a proposition for them. The negotiations seem polite enough, but have they wandered into the lion's den? Have they wandered deeper than that? Have they taken their rest in the predator's very mouth? Let's join them, shall we? Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the Crooked Thimble. As we play Iron Immortals, we have 3 players with us today. I am your host, Trick Dempsey, and I am the game master of this game. Joining me today is Brianna Dempsey as Impediment Reed. Brianna, where can people find you online?
Usually people can find me at Brianna N. Dempsey on Twitter. I also web admin at the Crooked Thimble and lurk on Facebook. You probably won't find me there.
As Kaya Wellsmythe, we have Hannah Garbaz. Where can they find you online?
You can find me on Twitter as CindersElla.
And finally, we have playing the intrepid Isolde Heisenberg, Bob Poteet. Where can they find you online?
Hi, yeah, you can find me at Robert Poteet on Twitter.
Holy cow, we got an actual answer this time. Guys, what's going on?
He's cowing to peer pressure?
I'm coming out of my shell. Yeah.
Is that healthy to shed your shell like that? I understand that can be tough for lawyers.
It might come back to haunt me.
Okay.
But that's okay.
Fair. Speaking of hauntings, when last we left our intrepid band, you were dining. You were having a late supper with Baron Sade Nyland inside of her fortress at Harris Reka. She had promised you to tell you some of the information of what she knows about the woods and about the artifact. In exchange for sort of you listening to that, she's going to reach a point where she's going to stop and demand that in order to proceed further, she will need assurances that she can have possession of the head. Some negotiation will, of course, happen there, but that is the overall gist of where we left off, sort of mid-sentence. Does everybody remember, like, their approximate arrangement at the table and the scenario surrounding that room?
Yes.
I remember,
You were playing footsie with Sir Ansa.
I am avoiding playing footsie. Well, I mean, maybe not avoiding, but it doesn't seem like quite the right time. I'm a little more concerned with eating, I think.
Fair. And we have tabled discussion of your gang.
Yeah, because I'm pretty sure I would not be able to respect any kind of hospitality once that starts.
I would also note that 2 members of our party have invitations to, after dinner, take part in some sort of rendezvous. Reed was invited to have a discussion with Olaf, the curious stranger, and there is an open invitation for Isolde to go and visit the brothers and sisters of the druids.
I'll be in my bunk. with the cat.
You'll be in the bunk with the cat, which has no fleas.
Then! So it's great. Thanks, Isolde.
No problem.
So the Baron says to you, my family has been keeping a secret of sorts for quite some time. And that secret is the location of the ancient city to the east of Fallfallow Glade. Now, with the changes of the forest and the shifting of the land even underneath it, its exact location can't exactly be known. We weren't the best geographers. What we do know is that that city had command of some very strange alchemy. They followed a sort of ancestor worship, and we had, for the longest time, assumed that this ancestor worship was merely a way of coping with the loss of all of the knowledge from, you know, all the people that die, because we are mortal creatures. But more and more we found references to essentially a specific technology, which would allow them to consult with the long dead. And this technology had something to do with the Iron Immortals. And around the time that we confirmed that through our research, we discovered a hand. The hand of a statue. Of an Iron Immortal, but an Iron Immortal with a hand. And with it, we were visited by a phantasm of sorts. We don't know its nature. It was simply a shadow. And people would remember happy memories if they touched it. They would remember childbirths and celebrations and weddings and late-night hookups. They would remember all sorts of strange, happy things because they would come in contact with this creature that seemed to be bound to the right hand. Over time, we were able to put together that there were other locations that had these parts, these artifacts. And each of them had a different kind of memory associated with it. We discovered where it was from. And it is from here. That is where the Immortal started. There is an iron well not far from us right now that has no statue. No Iron Immortal. And that head there is the head of that statue. It is the last part, the final memory or final aspect of it. And I believe that if it is reunited, we will be able to speak to that entity in its completion. That is what I am permitted to say. As I said, I greatly respect my word and the contracts that I agree to, and some things I have promised to keep secret. But none of those things, to my knowledge, should present you any kind of danger, and certainly not a danger associated with this entity.
If there's really no danger associated with this, why is there someone out there who doesn't want you to have it?
So we don't know who this is.
I don't, sadly.
I meant we don't know who this is a statue of.
Also true.
It could be an ancient warmonger. It could be an alchemist of some incredible repute. It could be somebody who knows how to make the nectar, and maybe it's just somebody from Brilliance who doesn't want us to know. We can't be sure. We just know that we don't think these memories that people experience when they touch it are all from a single person. But we don't understand. The only way that we can think to understand is the belief that this statue, when reunited, will provide us a great deal of knowledge.
Shrugs.
I'm certain you have questions.
Who are your other contracts or agreements with?
Well, the most obvious one is with Brother Venamo, the High Monk of the Druids, the High Brother. I don't understand the terms that they use. They tend to have some rather complicated titles. He has a collection of other artifacts from these before people. He keeps them in that reliquary, that tiny stone building. It's not tiny. That large stone building at the base of the Mott. He's shown them to me. It's where we compared notes and found a great deal of records, but the nature of those things are not my secret to tell. If he were to permit you to share in that information, I would be glad to discuss it, but it's not mine to say.
Are there others?
Other
people with whom you have agreements?
I have an agreement with... Well, we said we wouldn't have this conversation, but we'll have this conversation now, I guess. I have an agreement with Scarlet.
She keeps our menagerie, as she lovingly calls it, I think to mock me for calling our old wood creature stable back in town. Scarlet is the current jailer of the Greenbark Gang. In order to acquire her services, which have proven invaluable and have saved many lives, I had to hand over the Greenbarks to her. I do not like how she treats them.
That mean you plan on enslaving trees like her gang did?
The technology which she used to enslave the trees, I do not intend to use in that fashion. The technology she has lines our eastern wall and keeps it essentially impenetrable to them.
Huh.
That is the... There are also some of it... Some of her creations are inside of this fortress as well as around the well. There is no one else who knows how to make those than her. Her redstones are a miracle which I could not buy from her. I could only get her to manufacture them. She would not share their secrets.
She shouldn't. They're an abomination.
They could keep the settlements that are near the woods safe. Controlled and appropriately applied, they could be one of humanity's greatest boons. We could perhaps strike a peace with the forest if we could just assure that they couldn't destroy us when we came close.
I wish I could believe in trusting people that way.
I wish I could trust trees.
Trees are predictable.
Okay, quick question.
Yes.
Do Kaya and or Isolde know anything about what Reed is talking about?
Reed, what have you shared of the Redstone Gang?
She's totally not shared a goddamn thing.
She was keeping an important secret from me.
But Reed will, after this awkward brief silence, say thanks for confirming with my bluff there that it is Scarlet Redstone who has my family. I'll explain to you guys later. Reed kind of seems embarrassed when she says that to Isolde and Kaya. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I doubt they can be visited at this time, and I'm certain she would not take kindly to your arrival.
Yeah.
She is the first person to have told me about you. She does not have kind things to say.
I imagine I have worse things to say about her and her gang.
Yes, she has her own guard, soldiers who are mercenaries that work for her. She has grown quite rich in this settlement.
Well, yeah, you let her have all the sap she could want. And her gang's known for cutting their sap and selling it weaker or closer to poison. Like, you made a deal with a bad person, lady.
She's not the only one who gets the sap that we derive from the trees.
Well, good. Good, she doesn't have a monopoly. That would ruin you.
A good portion of them go to the Beyond, and Brother Venamo actually takes some of it himself. Apparently, the sap, not using the drug term for it, has more alchemical uses than simply your bizarre stimulant.
Well, of course it does. It's like the lifeblood of the most powerful things in the forest. How could it not be potent alchemically?
Indeed. I'm hoping that once it is out of the hands of the black market, or so exclusively into the hands of the black market, we might find more productive uses for it.
That's gonna get complicated.
I understand that you are very attached to the forest, and while you made a living from it, you had... Let me venture to guess rituals or beliefs or ways of acting that made your trespasses and your taking of sap be permissible. Is that correct?
Yes.
I would like very much, come morning, or maybe once you are ready to journey, you still look tired from your journey. Once you've fully recovered, I would love to take you to the woods along with perhaps Brother Arvo, and learn some of these techniques that you have. If there is ever to be a lasting human settlement near to the woods that doesn't cower in fear, we must be prepared to know its ways, the ways of the forest.
Maybe. Maybe you will be able to convince me that this isn't some stupid childish war. I'm gonna finish my food. You guys can talk about more important things now.
Oh, right. Yes, about the shadows and spirits and the technologically enabled necromancy. Yeah, a lot of questions.
I am not going to be the best at answering those, but I can venture. Brother Arvo actually nods to Brother Arvo, who is still in the room. Brother Arvo might know more than me. Well, yes, Brother Arvo has finished his stew and his wine. Yes, I know some things on the subject of. I never met one of the ghosts before. He looks over at Herman, the head.
Yeah, it's floating right there.
Yeah, it's a real thing. I didn't think it was a real thing. It's a real thing. Could you send it to the room or something? It could be listening or angry.
It's almost certainly listening and almost certainly angry.
The head is now turned to stare at Brother Arvo.
It's also learned that people are creeped out by looking at them, or by facing the head at them.
Oh, good.
That's part of what made the ruckus in the other room.
Well, what questions do you have, Professor?
I am curious about something that was mentioned earlier, that contact with these spirits, or with the pieces of statue, gave people visions.
Yes. It was recorded. I had... The other brothers who had reported it, we've all slowly become convinced that it's some sort of alchemical action, much like the unseen servants that some can conjure and construct, but that they've got some sort of contact poison or some sort of instability in the air, some ancient imperfection that makes their servants last a long time, but have this instability about them. When we began to catalog that each was different, we began to revise our theories.
And so none of you were able to speak with these spirits?
No, none of us know how to do that. You held a conversation with it.
That's right. It pleases me to be the first, I suppose.
What did it have to say? Please do tell. He reaches into a pouch and, like, pulls out a little notebook, basically, and is just, like, looking around for a place to, like, sets this little vial of ink and starts dipping a quill in it, and is just, like, looking at you like you were, well, food, and you saw what he did to food.
Right.
Reed is quietly getting the attention of a servant and trying to ask for a second bowl of stew.
The servant returns from downstairs.
This deserves attention? Shit. Okay.
And is bringing a letter, walks in, bows, and presents it to Kaya. Kaya, there's a letter for you. What do you do?
I kind of look at the servant. I take the letter. Does it have any markings on it?
It sure does. It has a familiar seal. It has a seal of the House of Jacquard.
Oh, how in the world did he... Okay, thank you. Is it customary to recompense in polite company a servant who does a special task for someone that they are not typically the servant of?
It is not. Normally, if anybody's going to be tipping them, it would be one of the footmen at the door.
Ah, okay.
You aren't actually kind of expected to deal with money.
Right. Well, I didn't know. Right. So I just smile and thank her and put it in my pocket.
Okay.
No way I'm opening that in front of the pot and everybody.
Izzold, I think Izzold just asked a question. I've got to cough 1 second. Izzold, did you just ask a question of Brother Arvo?
No, I was going to launch into a description of what I had found, or, well, what the spirit had said to me. Mostly along the lines of, get out, you're not welcome here, flee, be scared.
Wasn't there something about destroying the thing?
Yes. He wanted to extract a promise, you see, this spirit, that this piece of history, this iron immortal fragment, be destroyed.
Sir Anza and Baron Nyland sort of take a breath in at that and look over at the floating head. Brother Arvo is just carefully writing that down and then appears to be scribbling something just in the margin, which he seems to be quite excitedly doing.
Do you have thoughts on this, Brother Arvo?
Well, okay. If it can attempt to extract a promise, that means that the creature, or the hallucination, or the drug, or the whatever, was expecting two-way communication. If it can make two-way communication, then we may not need to assemble this artifact at all. Perhaps we can interrogate, speak to, converse with, these phantoms, without need of reuniting the immortal.
Perhaps.
Yes, well, I would consider its attitude towards this entire process quite hostile.
Indeed. How were you able to communicate with it?
Oh, you know that old alchemist trick. The, quicksilver solvent up the nose.
Oh, yes. You have the telepathy formula.
Yes, the telepathy concoction.
Certainly our own, supplies of it have been, running low. I'm going to go make a request to our stores to see if there's anyone in town who has sufficient amounts for us to prepare an investigation. Excuse me. And he stands up, taking his paper, plugging up his ink vial. Baron, if I may be excused, Baron Nyland's just like, please do. You have important work. Great.
If the servant who brought me the letter walks by again, I'm going to grab his or her ear real quick.
Yes, ma'am?
How did this missive, how was it delivered?
It was brought to us by a servant of Sir Jacquard. He's apparently has a tent in town.
Oh, really? How very interesting. Did the servant go back to the tent, or is Sir Jacquard here?
Sir Jacquard, I assume, is at his tent, or maybe in the beyond, though most of the nobility don't have their gatherings there. They've been, the knights have been sort of exchanging parlor parties inside of their field tents.
I see.
That is adorable. I love it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. She bows her head submissively and then continues to refill drinks. And picks up the empty stew bowl from Brother Arvo, and Brother Arvo's spot and leaves, Island says.
So now that we laid all of our cards out on the table...
Yes.
You won't... Oh, I'm sorry, Kaya.
Sorry, I just had a couple more questions. Ah. It shouldn't take too long.
Well, I'll continue drinking.
Read she or she on that.
Maybe Dang. You have questions too, Isolde. I was just wondering what you can tell me, what about the different types of memories? I mean, you mentioned the happy memory. Is there any other types of memory that you have received from the different parts and what you've determined? Or is that really still Brother Arvo's purview and he has now departed seeking alchemical formulae?
It's Brother Arvo's purview, but it's also on the edge of what I'm not entirely certain I ought to share. However, I do know that it's been a full range of emotions that the brothers and sisters have spoken about.
And you think it is more than one entity?
Well, it's strange. So the happiness spirit is probably the easiest one to describe. It has both... someone has experienced the... sexual male conquest, and someone has experienced childbirth, and generally those are not experienced by the same people.
Ah, indeed.
And that's what, amongst other memories that people have stated, has led us to believe that it must be some sort of compilation, or an elaborate invention of the mind that it touches.
Ah, and how many different minds has it touched?
I know that it is... come in contact with many of Brother Venamo's closest friends, but that circle, as far as I know, is not particularly big.
Ooh, burn.
That's not how that was intended. He's not a very trusting man.
I can understand that.
Well, you've given us much to think about, certainly, and I hope we have also given you a few tidbits to ponder. Obviously, Brother Arvo has gone off to seek more tidbits of information from other sources.
Yes, had he stayed, I would have told him the contents of the visions that I have received by dealing with this artifact.
Indeed.
I'm certain that would be appreciated down at their reliquary.
And is that where the various and sundry pieces are all stored together?
I can neither confirm nor deny the location of all of the sundry pieces.
It just does not necessarily strike me as wise to store them together. I don't know.
They are within the bounds of Harris Reka.
Ah.
But they are not far.
I see. Well, you have given us much to think about, certainly.
Evening is still... I must write many letters to traders and tradesmen to continue to supply this town.
Indeed. This very large and flourishing town. We obviously also would desire a consult. Perhaps we can meet in the morning and you can give us a more extensive tour of your town. We would enjoy seeing what you have built.
I would be glad to. It should be early. I like to assist in the morning exercises. So if you would like to return just after sunrise, I will have a quick breakfast prepared. And then I can show you around the lands. Currently, we have no knights of the Wellsmythe family having joined our expeditions. I would be interested to show you around so that you might convince them to send a knight or some of their men-at-arms to support the endeavor.
Interesting. Yes, you said you help join in the exercises. Would that be with the glaive or the bow? That kind of exercises?
I do mean those kinds of exercises. I personally prefer the sword, although she looks at the empty spot at the table. My brother has convinced me that the axe is a more suitable weapon. It just seems gauche to bring it into the forest itself.
Indeed, I can see how that might be the case.
It really is a little bit. I sometimes have regrets.
The woods do grumble, and they do grumble more when I bring an axe.
Mm-hmm.
Impediment reads, line of the night, I sometimes have regrets.
I must bid you adieu. Feel free to, of course, come and go as the apartment as you like. The servants will all be informed that you are staying the evening here. Might I recommend that you take an opportunity to maybe catch up with Brother Arvo or visit the Beyond? Reed, I would recommend you stay away from the menagerie, but I would highly recommend that you at least see its gate. And she points out, and the back of the house that adjoins it. Good night.
I would like to join you for the exercises in the morning. Will that be before or after breakfast?
That'll be after breakfast. The troops normally completely form up and finish their regular morning preparations around... I join them mid-morning.
Very well, then.
Baron, I'm sorry I spoke so quickly out of anger. Food has settled my temper a bit. Though I think there's still too much anger in me tonight to discuss why you sacrificed my family for your fortress. Perhaps in the morning we can discuss... I'm not as good with words as my friends. I want them out.
Do we still have a telepathic link right now?
You sure do.
Yep.
Telepathically indicate to Impediment, Just
you don't have a link with impediment.
You failed on impediment.
Oh right, never mind. Never mind.
Yeah, I know.
The walkie-talkie party.
I thought I swapped it out. All right, so now I'm going to Kaya. I'm like, uh oh.
She's awkwardly saying, "I want them out," and
Kaya is just going to kind of stand up. Really,
it seems like it would be really foolish to
abruptly here
do that on my own.
Reed,
what?
Reed, there are things we need to talk about. Obviously, let's not trouble the Baron anymore tonight.
I wasn't troubling her anymore tonight. That was all I had to say.
It was no trouble at all for you to bring up things which I am no longer responsible for or beholden to, she says as she walks into her apartment and closes the door. She doesn't slam it. She closes it quietly but swiftly.
Kaya's just going to kind of gesture everybody. Let's go into the apartment for now.
Sir Anza pipes up because she's still at the table.
Oh, yeah.
Might I recommend that you not, if you wish to have private conversations, that you not do it in the manner?
Kaya's just going to kind of look like her. I hope I have not impressed upon you an idea that I am a fool.
I just wanted to make certain that that was clear. I am going to go to the Beyond, have a drink, and retire to my tent.
Enjoy your tent and your drink, Sir Anza. Get some rest.
She takes a couple more bites of what remains of her stew, and then she's got like a wet pouch that she actually takes some more of it and puts it into that, and then takes that and leaves.
She has a pocket for stew?
She has a pocket for stew. She seems to actually, rather than pouring like soup in, she actually just took a couple of chunks of the meat and put it into that.
Love it. Love it.
She actually sort of bows to each of you as she leaves, as though she were greeting or departing from a peer rather than two unclassed people and a near peer.
Huh.
Interesting.
I mean, by this point, you know, the professor is kind of a lightweight. She's been drinking this whole time. She's a little sloppy right now. She returns a bow, a little curtsy or something. Yeah. Does it poorly.
Great job.
Awesome. So adorable. Are we alone in the room for now?
You're alone in the room for now. There are two servants who are just kind of, you know, messing about, cleaning up, doing servant stuff.
Kaya's going to kind of look at them. Obviously, we need to talk. As Sir Anza so eruditely pointed out, our apartment is not the best location. Unless, and she looks at Isolde, you can do something about the listeners in.
I mean, I can give it another telepathy another shot or something. Maybe. I don't know.
Didn't you forget it in the morning?
Right. I'd have to prepare spells again. It would take a while. You know what? I'm going to do something different. Serving fellow, if you could refill my glass.
Yes?
Yes.
It's a different fellow this time. Yes, sir?
Right, yes.
Pours you a new glass.
Filling the glass, and then as he's refilling the glass, I'm going to cast Charm Person on him.
Oh my.
Yeah. Huh?
Please roll this Charm Person.
All right.
Also, once you've made your roll, I'm very curious what Charm Person looks like.
Right, yes. It's going to be a perfume, a short-range perfume, I think, of ambergris and, I don't know, something elemental like antimony. Antimony?
Wow. Nice.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
You've got like a little spritzer there, and it's just like they come close, and like they were a cat, you just spray them.
an atomizer? That's going to be a total of 12 for cast a spell.
That's great.
Yeah.
What is the effect of Charm Person?
The effect of Charm Person is that the affected person is my friend. Until I prove otherwise.
Oh god, what kind of terrible, terrible name am I going to give this new character? Well, you would have to ask, but the Charmed Servant is... Oh god, that's so good. Alright, The charm servant is paying attention to you. Yes, madam. What can I do to help you?
Well,
you smell delightful this evening.
It's just something I whipped up to take the edge off the stink of the road. We've been traveling quite a long time. Now, you see, me and my friends here, we need to go somewhere to speak where we can speak without being listened in on. And I know that you've been working here for some time, at least long enough to know where such a thing could be found. Could you help me out? Show me somewhere where three friends and their intimidating cat and even more intimidating floating head could have a private conversation.
You have an intimidating cat?
Oh yeah, we got a cat. We got a bark cat with us.
I didn't know that. Wait, there's a bark cat in the manor? Like, looks around?
It's friendly. Well, don't worry. I deloused it, defleed it, cleaned it up. It's a delightful kitten, really.
Oh, what an absolutely adorable kitten, I am currently assured it is. Yes, of course there's a place where people may speak in private.
Yeah?
Might I could lead you to the beyond. Friend? Best friend?
That's right, friend.
The Beyond has many booths, and honestly, in all the boozing and the shouting and the various arrangements that are made with men and women there, nobody will hear what you say. Would you like to come drinking with me?
Well, let's leave that off for another time. After all, I've been traveling for quite a ways, and myself and my friends and my floating head and my friend's bark cat, we all need to have a private conversation. It might take a little while. Thanks, though.
Okay. He looks absolutely heartbroken. Like, his best friend just said no to drinks.
Aww.
Okay.
Tell me where you're at, and I'll meet up with you later, and we'll have a drink. How does that sound?
That sounds good. I'd like that. I'm at, and he gives you directions to a tent that's like way down the road. Like, you can tell that the shittier tents all sort of extend down the roads, even past where they appear on the map.
Yeah.
And it's pretty far. The servants don't live in the manor because the fortress isn't very big.
Well, great. Let us away then to... I turn to Kaya and to Reed and say, looks like we're going to have to talk at the Beyond.
Indeed. Let's grab Angus and take the floating head and make our way. Inconspicuously.
You do realize you can actually leave that someplace, you know, right?
Can we?
It followed us everywhere because it was possessed.
The unseen servant, as far as you know, is still following orders.
All right.
Except for the head turning order.
Yeah, well, there's only so much I can do. I guess I will leave the head in our room.
I will then leave Angus in the room guarding the head.
I am very much looking forward to the fan fiction of the conversation between Angus, the head, and the ghost.
I'm going to put a blanket over that head as well.
Oh, don't worry. Angus is adept at pulling blankets off.
This is great. This is wonderful. You leave them in the room. Angus is not having a tense standoff with the head. Angus is still asleep. But despite the fact that Angus does not appear to have, like, moved, like, there's no... It's definitely, like, the inverse Angus. Clearly, at some point, it rolled over, but who knows when.
No. Before we leave, I wake up Angus and tell it to guard the head.
Looks at the head?
Yeah.
Tilts like it was looking at, like, a laser pointer and starts sort of, like, getting really excited about what to do with the laser pointer?
No. I just give it the basic guard instruction and tell it to, you know, attack anyone that's not me that comes in specifically looking for the head.
It glares at Reed and it glares at Izzle.
I suggest you leave now and let me go in first.
Okay.
Leaving.
Goodbye, comfy bed.
This is perhaps also Kaya's way of making sure she gets to sleep on the now louse-free bed.
Great plan. That's a good plan you got there.
Yep.
So, Kaya.
Yeah?
You gonna open that letter yet?
Oh yeah, we're walking. How light is it outside?
It's pretty dark.
Well, then it's going to be difficult for me to read a letter, so nope.
Nope. Okay. Come on, light spells.
I'm not the alchemist here.
Super inconspicuous light spell.
You need a light spell? Should I whip up a light spell for you?
I'm aware that you want me to open your MacGuffin, but I'm not going to do it because it's not what Kaya would do. She's not going to open letter from Sir Jacquard until she's where she can do it without, like, too super calling attention to it.
In which case, shall we to the beyond?
Indeed, to the beyond we shall go.
So the beyond is the, if you want to look on the map, it is that large structure that is outside of the walls. It is a massive public house that Reed is currently standing on top of. It has, like, a beer garden. That's that attached area on the southwest. But it also, like, that beer garden has spilled across the road, and that is where seemingly, like, all, possibly, the soldiers are right now, along with a strange mixture of servants and traders and tradesmen. So to list all of the people at this pub would be insane, but there are a number of tables outside. However, inside is absolutely packed with people. Outside, there are corners of the beer garden that have already emptied out, but the inside, there is a band playing and some sort of performer doing acrobatics or something to that effect on the inside. So if you were to go in, it is loud and ruckus, and you would probably be standing room only at this point. But if you want to just find a quiet-ish table that is still surrounded by a bunch of drunks catcalling women and men, because why not? Let's just let that happen both ways in this culture. Then you could go outside.
All right, let's go outside because Kaya has had enough of the not sitting down. We've done that a lot lately.
Fine by me, as long as I get some beer.
Yep.
A muscle-bound, shirtless man wearing baggy pants comes by and takes. So, what would you ladies like to drink tonight?
Beer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Just two beers?
Reed.
Sorry, distracted by Pex.
You were distracted by what? He crosses his arms and they sort of, like, flex.
Yeah, that's fine.
Tee-hee.
She wants a long, tall drink of water. You'll do.
His boobs are bigger than mine.
Isolde, many people's boobs are bigger than yours.
Oh, burn. He struts away. He's gonna bring your beers in a bit. You have your private conversation.
So, Reed.
Yep.
You should tell us things about this scarlet person and this redstone gang and this stuff that you haven't told us about.
Yeah, Reed, you've been keeping secrets from me and Kaya.
And me. But Isolde is feeling especially insulted.
And the bark cat. What was his name again? Angus, that's right.
Angus.
Angus, you've been keeping secrets from Angus too.
But Angus doesn't care.
Angus is a great confidant. He's good. He's good.
Yeah. You've probably told Angus.
Yeah. You know, late nights, sleeping, sorrow, not happening. Cats are great for that. Have you ever wondered why me, a sap runner, isn't running with a gang?
Well, I figured...
Yeah, something horrible happened to your gang.
Yeah, and I'm really hoping that you don't actually know much about that, Isolde, but honestly, your folks are the ones who put them away in the first place, so... but you seem too nice to be involved.
That's
in that.
Typical admin bursar behavior, you know, locking people up on drug crimes, those sort of ridiculous stuff. I am all for legalization of SAP.
I appreciate that. Anyway,
he's just quietly joined. He's great. It's Isolde Sanders.
Decriminalize, destigmatize.
Wow. My gang got taken in, and I'm still not sure how, but they tried to get me to do a lot of things. Sap running gangs have secrets, and they got me twisted up, inside out, backwards. I thought the rest of my gang had been killed, and I was too much of a coward to follow them. So I rolled on another gang, the Redstone Gang. The worst of our competitors I could think of. They have no respect for the forest, and they have no respect for the people who need sap, the people who use sap. They only respect their own power and their own wealth.
You hear knocking by the road, hammering on a signpost, and you see over by that signpost, Olaf the Curious Stranger is nailing signs to the roadside posts.
Huh.
This late at night. Sign nailing.
Well, I mean, there's a ruckus party going on.
Well, I mean, this part of town clearly never ends.
Yeah, but, you know, some people like to see where they hit the nails.
There are torches by the road, mostly for the beer garden. And many of the tents have lamps out.
All right. So, yeah, I usually don't talk about that.
So this scarlet person has a lot of reasons to dislike you.
Yeah, I take it. And it was originally a complete bluff on my part to find out if that's who had my gang, since, well, her name means red, and I could only think of one gang that... I could only think of one group that would want my gang.
And abominations?
Huh?
What are the things that she does that you find so despicable?
I never saw it with my own two eyes, but it was pretty commonly accepted among the gangs that the Redstone Gang had some way to actually trap saplings, and rumor had it they were working on trapping bigger trees and bigger brush, and we're just going to keep them captive and drain them dry of all of their sap, without giving anything back to the forest at all. That is what I meant.
Ooh.
Sap, as great as it is, you're essentially sucking the lifeblood out of the forest. And if you're not willing to risk giving some of your own back, you have no business dealing in sap.
Isolde, at this point, is like crying ugly tears. Ugly crying at this horrible, horrible, tragic story.
Yeah, so as Isolde cries, Reed does get more choked up, because, you know, the whole stoic trying to repress the feeling of it thing is really hard to do when someone else is already crying.
Stop crying. If you don't stop crying, I'll start crying.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Kai is just going to kind of look at them.
The heartthrob server returns.
She looks up at him. Thank goodness for beer.
I could probably use something harder.
Yeah, you need a drink, and you need a drink, and you need a drink, and you need this hand towel. He hands Isolde a pretty dirty looking hand towel, but nonetheless, you need to. Oh, you poor thing. Do you need a bard to come cheer you up? Do you need a man or a woman to come bring you comfort?
I need you to keep 'em coming. slams the beer. Inadvisably.
Wow. Absolutely.
I knew there was a reason I liked her.
Runs off to get more beer.
Okay, so, like, we need to get your friends back. You're not your friends, you're family. We're just friends. Those green barks are your family. And we need to get them back. You were holding on to this for this whole time. This whole time, Reed.
I thought they were dead. I didn't know until Shimshackle.
Shimshackle.
He owes me his life, you know. That's Shimshackle.
Where is... I mean, I kind of... Do you have any idea where he might have gone? I mean, he wouldn't have come back here to try to free his friends, would he? I mean, didn't strike me as the type.
You know what I said about being willing to pay the price to the forest?
Uh-huh.
Who do you think vouched for us?
Ooh.
I'm hoping he was faster and got the hell out. He's smart and he's fast, so maybe he did, but we won't know till we see him again.
Was anybody looking around while having this discussion about Shimshackle's whereabouts?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Keeping a ready eye on all people who should not be listening in on conversation.
Oh, that's really... That's great. I would like one of you, either of you, to give me a discern realities check, since you were looking around and asking appropriate questions.
I think I... Can I aid on that? Is that a...
Yeah, sure. If you were looking around, or... But if you were genuinely, like, caught in the reverie of saying, oh no, he's dead, oh no, then probably not.
No, Reed's probably pretty emotionally effed right now. She's probably not entirely with it.
I got a 12.
Wow, a 12's really good. It's a good roll. You get 3 questions on the crazy list.
I do. Ah, the crazy list. It's my favorite list. It's full of things and realities.
You're looking for the list, aren't you?
No, it's right here. One of these
it's
three. Yeah, there
it's
it is.
It's a great list. It's a huge list.
it's a huge list.
Huge. It's got a words.
And we're going to make brilliance pay for it.
God damn it.
What?
You realize there is a giant wall on the west side of the Empire.
Wow.
You're going to make the raptors pay for it.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Giant wall. All right. What here is useful to me?
What here is useful or valuable to you is that on the very far distant side, past to the southeast, there's sort of a curve in the wall of the fortress.
Uh-huh.
Someone is watching from the brush by that wall.
Ooh.
And that is either useful or valuable to you.
Yeah. What is about to happen?
What is about to happen is that the group of mercenaries that are about 2 tables away from you, their argument that has been growing louder is about to turn violent.
Ooh. What here is not what it appears to be?
I love that question.
I know.
The acrobat who was dancing inside before is now outside smoking something from a pipe. And watching them, you can tell that they are no common acrobat. They are no wandering performer. That is a fighter of some kind.
I see. Alrighty then. That was 3 questions.
What do you do?
Oh,
I'm gonna give you a quick freebie because there's something I probably should have said.
Uh-huh.
Some people are very, especially soldiers, are very excited about the signs that have been put on the signposts.
Oh, well then.
Shit.
Well, I'm going to telepathically ask Kaya if she can read the signs from where she's sitting. Oh,
aren't you Kaya?
Ask Isolde if she can read the signs.
It's been a while.
We've been connected too long. Our identities are starting to merge.
Indeed.
Huh? What? Oh, right. Wiping away the tears, I look over at the sign.
The sign is a handwritten announcement that tomorrow there will be a special games at the menagerie. They are going to see how long those damned kids last.
Oh dear.
I'm going to kill her. I'm just gonna.
It's okay.
It says, in honor of our special guest.
Ooh.
Damn.
Is the guy still sitting over there being sneaky around the southwest corner?
Sure. Southeast. Yeah, well, yes. Whatever. That yes. Person is still over by the wall being sneaky.
All right. I will point out. I will say, Kaya. I will say, seriously.
This is the best.
Ooh, I'm Isolde. You're Kaya, right?
Which one is drunk? Oh, that must be why you're getting the names mixed up, because you're telepathically linked to someone drunk out of their mind.
We're both drunk.
Wee! Okay.
We're sharing the burden.
I'm gonna look over at Isolde and be like, there's no way this is gonna, she's gonna be helpful in this situation.
I'm great.
I'm gonna look at Reed and be like, ditto. Okay.
Reed is slightly more put together than Isolde, because she's not drunk yet at all.
But she's writhing mad. Okay.
She's just really angry. Just like...
Okay, so I'm gonna lean over to Reed and be like, okay, so I think we're being watched.
That doesn't surprise me.
Yeah, so I'm gonna kind of be like, so look over, don't do it right this minute, but in a minute, when I say something funny, just like laugh and look over at that southeast corner and see if you can see the person. Then I'm gonna lean back.
Okay.
And, you know, start pretending like I'm telling a joke or something, gesturing expansively, and then...
This is really strange.
I'm just giving you an opportunity, so it doesn't... It's not obvious that we're looking at this person, so maybe we can catch them out.
Do you need some jokes?
Yes.
I got a few.
Isolde, tell a good joke. Not about farting.
Why not about farting?
Because I've heard all the fart jokes.
There are only so many fart jokes, it's true.
I was wondering why that juggler's ball was getting bigger when it hit me. Ah? Ah?
And Reed tries to look over at the person in the dark.
Reed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Shimshackle is watching all of you from the dark.
Aha.
Shimshackle may be making bird noises in an attempt to get your attention.
I think I need to take a
walk?
Yeah, nature calls.
Oh, that was
hilarious. Does nature say,
and I think I remember there being some decent bushes to nature call over that direction.
All right. Enjoy the calls of nature. Indulge them. You know, be careful. Don't fall into the bush or anything.
Does anyone else maybe need to or want to?
I mean, going to the bushes together is what us women do, right?
Yeah. Kaya's just gonna kind of
meeting by the bushes.
Yeah, yeah. Go to the bushes, Reed and Isolde. I'll stay here and make sure nobody takes our table.
In groups. Okay. Strength in numbers. That's right.
All right.
Yeah.
That's us.
Yeah.
I kind of have to take a leak
also,
too.
Also, I maybe am concerned that you might not be able to walk so well on your own, Isolde. You drank that real fast.
Drink one real fast. All right, there needs to be another one. Where's my next one? Tell him to bring another when he gets back. And
I will.
Stumbles, getting up.
There's like a full-on wrestling match happening two tables over as a group of mercenaries are just having it out about a relationship with some third party.
Ugh.
Ugh. Ugh.
Sounds like fun on a different night. And
as
we'll skirt around
the
edges.
As my compatriots leave, I will take out the letter.
The letter is quite short.
Indeed.
It simply says, "My dear Ms. Wellsmith, it has been too long since I saw your pleasing face. Mine is the purple field tent near the well." And it is signed EJ.
EJ. Ugh. All right. Okay, then. I will smile nervously and put it back in my pocket. And then, you know, kind of twist my fingers in my hair for a minute.
What is that about?
Okay.
I don't get to know yet. Okay, I can deal with this.
Yeah.
From an alarmingly close distance. As you guys are approaching these bushes, supposedly to pee,
mm-hmm.
Shimshackle is going,
"Caw-caw!
Oh, knock it off. We can see you.
We have to stay secret.
Well, as much as anything can here.
Also, no one seems to care.
Like, looks over at the group of people that are at, like, the beer garden and is just like,
no one's watching us.
Yep.
Well, all right then. How's it going, Reed? I see that you got out okay.
I'm so glad you're alive.
Yeah, of course I'm alive. Like, why wouldn't I be? I'm Shimshackle. I always get out of a jam.
Reed is desperately swallowing back those tears that Isolde so kindly evoked earlier.
Reed, did you get pollen in the eyes? You look congested. It can't be that, though. Not over poor Shimshackle. Shimshackle's just fine.
Oh, shut up, Shimshackle. And she picks him up in a hug.
You're the worst. You're the worst, Shimshackle. You, like, left. And now you're making fun of Reed because she's showing a little bit of vulnerability right now. We should beat the shackle out of your shim. Yeah. I'm going to sit down.
Hugs you back. Reed's just fine. Reed's unbreakable.
Oh, God.
That's what we call you, unbreakable Reed.
Ugh, they broke the hell out of me, Shim.
Nah, that's not true. That's not true. We're going to break them right back, right?
I hope so.
Yeah, the Baron just gave us some tips on how to break into Scarlet.
Wait,
Scarlet.
Is that what that was?
Yeah, you were too to notice. It's fine. Yeah, we'll just... We'll go over there tonight.
Reed sets Shim down and kind of holds Isolde by the shoulders. Shit, I don't know how to sober someone up, only how to get them more high. What do I do?
So wait, let me get this straight. The Baron Nyland, isn't helping Miss Scarlet?
I... All I could make out from the sideways things she was saying was she didn't like how Scarlet was treating my people.
Well, that's good enough for me. I'm taking her off the list. Pulls out a sheet of vellum, and he's got a little piece of charcoal, and it's got these, like, pictures of people on it, and, like, little images of knives over some of them, and he just rubs one of the knives off and actually just erases the whole person.
That's the best. That's fantastic. That is the best.
He has a list. An illiterate list.
Yep.
He pulls out a second red piece of charcoal, like a red chalk, and just adds more red hair to the one that's got red hair, and then more blood dripping from the knife.
Yeah. So, Isolde?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Come back to us, Isolde.
Mm. All right, Kaya's going to telepathically check in. Everything okay, Isolde?
Yeah, things are fine. You know, actually, if you could get me a tomato juice, an egg, water, some celery if they got it, and some saltpeter, yeah, I think I'm gonna want those things.
Okay.
What fucked up Bloody Mary did you just make?
This is the hangover cure.
All right.
The alchemist's hangover cure.
I'm gonna signal the bartender and tell him, take a Bloody Mary and get rid of the bacon and add saltpeter. Thanks.
Yeah, you got it, babe.
Thanks.
Like, walks off. Sachets off. Let's make this better.
That's the best. This is the best bar person.
Don't forget the raw egg. Raw egg's important.
Okay.
I'm gonna take a nap right here. Lie down.
Oh, Isolde.
Once I have
so
the drink.
You are so tiny and so confusing.
So, where you kids staying at tonight? You know, have you heard any news from town? I've been scared to go into town.
Did you see the guy nailing up the sign?
Yeah, I saw guys. They nail signs all the time. They have their weird chicken scratches on them. They say they got meaning, but they don't have meaning. Only these have meaning, these pictures. Their pictures are bad. My pictures are good.
Yeah. I like your pictures. My friends read their letters, and Scarlet's gonna do something real nasty to our kin tomorrow.
No, she's not, Reed, because we're gonna cut her up.
Or at least get him out tonight. Either way, I'd be fine with that. I don't know if I want to drag this poor little thing and my other friend into something like that. Unknowing, and she's clearly not able to know a damn thing right now. I'm a little jealous.
Oh, no, says Isolde, who's, like, lying on the ground to stop the world from spinning. No. We're gonna help get your kin back. This cannot be borne. It is unsupportable that this Scarlet is doing these horrible things. We're gonna get her.
I'm gonna retcon a piece of information onto the announcement. The announcement stated that it would be after the afternoon exercises.
Okay, so we have some more time.
So you have some more time.
That's good.
That's nice. Alright, so I'm gonna saunter over with this concoction and an egg. Here you go.
Isolde sits up, takes out her alchemist kit, whips together a modified Bloody Mary and some raw egg. There's some saltpeter on top. Lights the thing on fire.
What?
Blows it out and then slams it.
You're terrifying, little one.
Okay. All right. We're gonna want to do this.
Some people are watching now.
Ooh. Well, we're gonna take a little break. We're gonna get back to the party.
Shim, stay down. As far as they know, two ladies just took their very drunk friend to the bushes.
Right. So, Shimshackle, we need to meet up somewhere where we won't be watched. Where can we meet you?
I mean, I can just wait to the crossroads to the south. I could meet you out west. Not many of them go out west because you know that's just the farmlands. So I could head down the west road, and I could meet you there
somewhere near where Scarlet is set up.
Oh, near where Scarlet is set up. Ah, well, there are no watchtowers around Scarlet. So if you were to just meet me over there on the northwest side of Scarlet's little shithole horror show over there. That'd be great. I get sharpen my shiv. I've only got this shiv.
Oh, for the love of... Shim, take my spare knife. I give him my spare knife. It's a dagger.
Yeah. Yeah, this is right. I call this dagger Justice now.
Oh my god, Shim.
Justice Revenge. That's its first name and its last name.
That's great. Okay.
He totally golems away, like...
Well, clearly we're helping our very drunk friend walk back from going to the bathroom in the bushes.
And lighting things on fire.
Yeah, well, alchemists, that's how they go to the bathroom, right? Right?
Yeah, that's how I heard it works.
Get out of here, Scrimshackle. I'm going. Leave. Golem bye. Away.
Later, bye.
As they walk back, Kaya's gonna be like, so, did you hear the one about the alchemist who went to the bathroom?
Did they light their fart on fire?
Oh, that's a good one. I have to remember that one.
I asked you not to tell any more fart jokes.
I'm sorry, you know that's a promise I can't keep.
Yeah, that's why I told the joke. So I could tell the joke about the joke. Made you laugh.
It looks like the fight's been broken up by a very large and intimidating looking superior officer of some kind. A man who is still in armor and has a big bushy beard and that look of terrifying authority. And on the other side, the other person is being restrained by Barker.
Oh, hi.
What do you do?
Go back to the table. Sit down. They're fighting, not my problem.
Yeah, kind of keeping an eyeball on Barker. There were things I wanted to ask him, but I've gotten pretty distracted and I'm not sure what I was going to ask.
Fair, there's a lot going on.
There's a lot going on. How you feeling any better, Isolde?
Yeah, feeling
feeling salty. That's how the that's how the hangover cure works. It's not really a cure. Just, you know, puts off some of the ill effects that I'm sure will be coming. Right. Yes. So, to clarify before, Baron Nyland did give us some tip on a way in which we can rescue your kin, the Greenbark Gang. I would recommend we do it as quickly as possible, or at least wait a few hours until the dead of night, past party hour.
That seems wise, like try and get there when everyone's asleep.
So I'm just gonna point this out.
Yeah.
How big is this gang? How many people are we talking about here?
Before I thought everyone was dead, Reed starts counting on her fingers. Trick, I can't remember what we talked about.
The total number of current living members of the Greenbark Gang, to your knowledge, assuming none of them had been executed, would be 6. Yourself is included in that 6.
We were pretty small. There were only 6 of us before we got caught.
And how many does Scarlet
I have
man?
No idea how many.
Well, there's an even more basic question. Assuming that we have to hide 5 people somewhere, where do we hide 5 people?
We're going to have to trust in the Greenbark Gang's ability to go to ground.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so we're just going to release, not worry about protecting after the releasing. I can get down with that.
I mean, it's not your guys' responsibility to do that for them, and I'm not sure they'd want to have me back anyway after how I failed them.
Well, you know we have your back, and it's always nice to have you owe me one, Reed, so I'll help you out a little.
Thanks. Yeah, if we knew we had any friends here.
Oh.
It would be a good stepping stone before going to ground in the forest, but...
She fingers the letter in her pocket. I don't know. I could talk to somebody, but I don't know if he's to be trusted or not. Don't know.
Why, Kaya, this is the first time I've heard you express such doubts about a gentleman friend.
Isolde, it's not like that. It's my old mentor. It's not Isolde.
Do you blush at gentleman friend?
Are you sure that hangover cure worked?
I feel great right now.
Yeah, you're being a little weird. Anyway, I can ask him, but it'd probably be best if you guys wait here.
It does sound like a gentleman friend.
I know, doesn't it?
Kaya's just getting redder and redder and redder in the face.
I figure we have some time. Probably.
We will want to wait until partying dies down. There's a good chance that the later watches will be less disciplined than earlier ones.
All right.
Okay.
In which case, it would be fine for you to take some time to speak with your... Did you say it was mentor?
Yeah.
Totally mentor. Fishing for more details there.
That's what I said.
And I think it's fair to also remind you, Isolde, now that you're more... The druids did have an offer to chat with you about things you seemed really interested in.
Yeah, so I would like, if possible, to maintain my at least good standing in the town so that I could go visit them later. This seems more important right now, but if we have some time, how late in the evening is it?
Let's be kind. I mean, it's not super late. You guys, like, went and had a slightly late supper and then have proceeded down here. It is nearing, like, 10, maybe?
All right, so we could split our little party and have different adventures
and talk to different people at different ends of town.
And then meet back up and see if we have a better idea for how to get folks out safely.
Yes, let's meet back here about midnight.
Seems... Or do we just want to meet where we said we'd meet Shim?
Yes, we could do that.
We can... If you guys stay together, then we can just coordinate, because, you know, telepathy.
Yep.
True. Though I think the druid stuff will bore the hell out of me.
I know, it'll be awful. But it'll be alright. It won't last that long. I promise I'll keep my questions limited to, you know, the dire stuff and immediate things at hand, and not the exact specifics of, well, necromancy and ghosts.
Reed, there is a lot of dancing and revelry going on around here.
I know, a lot that's of... what I was trying to get some time to do.
Let me see if I can look up the exact phrase that I might use to describe this. I would say that there are definitely mortal pleasures to be had here.
I know!
Mortal pleasures.
You guys are trying to drag me from my den of sin!
No, you should stay here, you should have some fun, get all pumped, and then we're gonna go rescue your family.
Thanks.
Alrighty then, so...
Thanks, great plan.
I'll see you later somewhere! Bye!
Professor and Kaya, which of you would like to have your little micro-adventure first?
Professor may go first. I'm fine with waiting.
Okay. I'll take that.
So, Professor, you approach the reliquary and the essentially small campfire and the druids. There are only, let's say, four of them gathered out front of this heavy metal door, if you remember that, of the reliquary. And it's got a low stone wall sort of shielding it from even further elements. And they're just cooking and drinking. And you can see Arvo excitedly speaking to a dour-looking gentleman with a beard. All of them are in their brown monk's robes. And the other two around the campfire just seem to be chatting about something else. What do you do?
Stride in, confident in my robes, and say, "Good evening, gentlemen, philosophers, and druids all. It is I, Professor Isolde."
Oh yes, this is the professor I was telling you about. Sorry, actually, that's not how he talks at all. Yes, this is the professor I was telling you about. May I introduce you to Brother Venamo, the head of our order?
Charmed.
Yes, charmed. It is a delight to meet you, such a revered professor. I hope that you are well.
Oh, has Brother Arvo been doing me reverence? I look at him and wink. I am delighted that I have given such a warm reception among such an august order of intellectuals.
I have been trying to receive the publications from the Ethnographic and Tactical Studies group. I do hope that your school will accept a druid's petition to get one of your publications.
Oh, isn't the administration and the publishing department the worst?
Absolutely. They just don't understand the value of good coin.
And free trade of ideas. I was hoping to have such a trade tonight.
That would be delightful. I hear that you have had contact with the ghost.
That's a fine title for it. Well, how many G's do we want to write down on that? I take out my book and start writing it down.
I have gone with 3, and then a final G that is connected to the rest of ghost.
There should be a hyphen in there, I think.
I've been experimenting with the most dramatic ways that it might be accorded in text. Do tell me, what did you see when it touched you?
Horrible things.
Okay, great.
Death by freezing on a mountain, death by burning. Now, I understand that you have had a variety of vision types from other pieces of the... Have you named the Iron Immortal? The test subject? Maybe given a number?
We are calling it the Titan.
The Titan. The Titan. That's great.
Since it appears to be a person, it needs some powerful-sounding title.
Right, of course. See, I didn't know that when I had to come up with a name for the piece that I had, the head. Yeah, so I named him Herman. Anyway.
Herman the Titan.
Right.
It could work. It could. I will have to consult a dramaturge to see if there is a legend that conflicts with that name.
Yeah, you should get on that. Or at least have one of your research assistants. And I look around at the other druids.
They wave, we don't, we're not called that here. We're just brothers in the Order of Druids. Would you like some mead? They're offering you mead, Isolde.
I'll take a sip. I'm kind of a lightweight, you know.
This mead, now that you've taken a sip, is more like rum.
Whew! Gonna get me spilling all my secrets, gentlemen. Oh my.
I'm certain that is not our purpose. Do tell us, what is it that brought you news of Herman?
Well, that's a long story. I'll start from the beginning, and then I will launch into a very long and boring story about the funding problems that the Department of Ethnographic and Tactical Studies has been experiencing since the beginning. Meanwhile, though, I want to try and read the room. How are they feeling about this brother Venarmo? Does he command their respect?
Give me a discern realities.
All right, that's going to be an 8 total.
So you get to ask one question from the discern realities list. Yeah.
Who's really in control here?
It is definitely Brother Venamo. But Brother Venamo, everyone seems very nervous about him. Like, he's definitely the boss. And in fact, it seems that, as your suspicion was, that the offer of a drink may have been an instruction. They are scared of him. This is... You've met people who rule by being inspirational. That would be Baron Nyland is an inspiring leader. People repeat her rhetoric. You've met people who lead by strength. This is a man who leads because people are afraid to cross him.
Right. So, with that in mind, I am punching above my weight here. So, Isolde will affect a yawn and will say, oh, there's so much more else to tell about how I got word of the artifact and how I came to join such a thriving community here with such a...
Let me be more
delightful
clear.
Delightful fraternal, yes?
You have this mysterious benefactor who also knew about Herman. I would be delighted to know a little bit more about this benefactor.
As would I, I'm sure. And we will explore such delights at a later time. Perhaps tomorrow? I'm dreadfully tired. Whatever it is you gave me has gone straight to my head.
Oh, absolutely. I had not intended to speak to you when you were compromised in any way. That is not the message that I would like to send.
Of course not. Of course not. It's just, you know, I am kind of a lightweight. I'm sorry I can't keep up with you boys.
Would you be interested? We have more comfortable quarters that the brothers and I share. If you would like, I'm certain that those will be kinder than any arrangement that you can make with Able Public.
Oh, yeah, forward of you, sir. I am not interested in those delights
oh,
tonight.
Goodness. Not like that at all. He looks, like, nervous. You misunderstand, madam.
Oh, I am just kidding. Brother, I am kidding. No offense taken at all. But I must go and rejoin my friends and ensure that they're comfortable for tonight. Do not worry, my quarters have been provided for. It is a delight to meet you all. Brother Arvo, again, a pleasure to see you. Brother Venamo, we will continue this at a later time. All respects.
Do tell me, you are traveling with a Greenbark, though, yes?
Oh, who? Greenbark? Is that name? You mean that gang?
Yes.
Oh, they're going to be executed tomorrow, all the Greenbarks.
They're going to what?
Hmm? Oh, you hadn't heard?
No. You repeat that.
The Greenbarks. They're going to be executed, mm-hmm. right?
Oh, that won't do at all.
Well, it's above my pay grade.
Hmm. Indeed. Thank you for telling us that. When tomorrow is this execution
There's
to take place?
There's some notice in town. Send one of your runners to look at it.
That's great. He leaves.
Ta-ta!
He's gone. He just storms off.
Brother Arvo, I call over before I leave.
Yes.
What's with Venamo and the Greenbarks?
Venamo was their previous stakeholder. I wouldn't know. A title holder? Possessor, one might say. They were integral in our understanding of improving the sap. Yes, that's... They are important. They have quite a lot of knowledge and certain special properties.
Well, thank you, brothers. Have a good night. And then I will go and return to...
Would you like to leave with some of this? I'm certain that the rest of your band would enjoy our delightful mead.
Oh, yes, please. I'll take a mead.
They give you a skin of the mead.
You're so generous, druids. Druid brothers. Brother friend.
They return to smoking their pipes, which smell rather skunky, and drinking their mead.
That is some fine herb, but I'll take my leave now.
Kaya!
Ah, all right. I am headed to the purple tent, which I noted as we were walking in. I'm not sneaking, but I'm, walking as if I know where I'm going, which I kind of do, but, I'd rather not be observed.
You're going into a tent city. You're totally going to be observed.
Okay, but I'd rather not be followed. I'd rather not be observed, especially.
Okay, fair. You do your best, like, in this setting. You're not, as far as you can tell, it doesn't look like anybody got up from a table or even, like, kept an eye on you. Though, like, interestingly enough, with the distance that you've traveled, you can see, if you can see on the map there, it is just that large purple tent next to the well there. You could, if you really craned your neck, like, see the table you were at.
Ah, that's not very far at all.
No, it's less than a football field's distance away.
All right. Well, it's a tent, so you can't really knock. What's the accepted practice for a tent? Probably
It's interesting, so you notice that, like, this immediate area, the places that are right next to the well, uh-huh. all appear to be nobles' tents. So they're a little bit more built, like they have, like, wooden corner posts, and they've got curtains that go all the way to the ground. The sides of them are these are cloth houses, practically. Ones that have noble sigils on them, have family symbols, all have servants waiting by the door. There is no servant waiting by the entrance to this one.
Ah, interesting. I know he has a servant.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, I shall gently rap upon the pole, I guess. And no answer. Perhaps a little more firmly.
Is that you, Miss Wellsmith?
Yes. Yes, it is. Here I am. Hi.
Hey. There was already lamplight inside.
Uh-huh.
But you see one approaching the door. Please do come in.
Okay. I assume that is the voice of my mentor, so I shall enter.
Absolutely it is. What does he look like?
Ah, he is in his early 50s. He kind of looks like a slightly skinny Sean Connery.
Fair beard, no beard?
Beard.
Beard.
Beard, salt and pepper, bushy eyebrows, but a little bit gaunt, you might say. He's got kind of the look of like a wolf that looks down upon you. He's very tall. Why do I always like the tall men?
This Edvard that you walk in to see is changed from how you knew him.
Oh.
He has the sun has been unkind. He's tanned, but he's clearly seen a lot more outdoor work than even his time training and exercising with you would see. He is much more fit than you remember seeing him, but he doesn't look like he's slept. He looks, his normally fierce eyes look tired. He is wearing town clothes. Let's not go into the fineries that would mean, but he's not in his pajamas and he's not in combat attire. He's in relaxing wear that you might expect someone to have around town if they were rich.
Nice. As nice, nicer, or less nice than things I have seen him wear before?
More practical. So I would say less nice. Okay. And it's been repaired. So it has some seams and stitches and stuff that haven't been, you know, completely fixed.
This might even be a thing that I have seen him wear before.
Yes. You've actually seen this outfit before.
Okay. It's not... Okay.
It's something that he likes.
Ah.
He's fond of.
I look around. Well, you've certainly got a good location for your tent here, sir. I didn't know you were coming out to these parts.
Well,
what are you doing in Harris Rica?
Birgitta wants more land to pass on to our next child.
Of course Birgitta wants more land. We've talked about this. Birgitta always wants more land. Birgitta will never not want more land.
She does, but now that she's with child for a second time, that's news to you. The need has become more dire. Our lands are small and not particularly significant, and we want to have something better for our children than we have for ourselves.
Don't we all? So
yes,
you are here in Harris Rica to pursue that? Doesn't
Baron Nyland is the only member of the Order of the Wood who is commanding a force to take new land.
Okay. And she is awarding it to...
The knights that are in her service are going to be able to split up parcels that we conquer.
I see.
I will actually be... I have made an arrangement with the lord to the southeast of us, of my own lands, of my own manor. And we're going to do a land exchange of sorts, so that it will simply expand the territory near the manor itself.
I'm sure Birgitta will be happy with that.
She is. She's always loved the stream that passes through there.
Oh.
It's a place that the Tegu like to play when they can.
The Tegu. You didn't bring any with you. I don't see any Tegu here.
We have stables in the barracks. We try to keep them contained. They get antsy because of the presence of the menagerie. So
really?
the fortress itself actually contains the Tegu.
Oh.
I could show you once day comes. They're not active when it's this cold at night.
True. What about the menagerie scares them? I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, goodness. It's informative to face. He actually slides up the sleeve on his left arm, and he shows you a burn that he has. They have forest creatures like I've never seen on a campaign. They have a sapling with toxic vines. They have sap spiders that can spit, and it's not webbing that they spit. This Why menagerie do... is a training unlike I have ever seen.
Why do they keep such a thing? That's not sane.
They're local to just a little ways deeper into the wood. And this is the first time that many of the men who fight here, the men and women who fight here, have ever seen anything like it, have ever faced a sapling, ever faced sap spiders. And we can't have soldiers breaking when they first encounter the enemy. So we train against them. Scarlet has a way of commanding them back and forth, not much more than that. And it provides us some modicum of safety when training against creatures so dangerous.
What was the sign I saw? Something about... It sounded like they were doing some sort of execution. It didn't seem very like much like training.
She has nailed the sign outside. She has this group of... She'll call them freaks. Prisoners from the university. The sap runners, criminals. I mean, honestly, if they were on my land and doing what they'd done, I would have also had them hanged.
Running sap? You don't think that what's being done in the menagerie is any worse?
Being done in the menagerie is good for the kingdom. But if you've ever seen people strung out on the sap or the desperate means that they will take to acquire more of it, that's the thing you see with all of these gangs, is that they eventually find them as a means of providing leverage against the people who are hooked.
I see.
It's the worst.
Sap is the worst.
Hopefully, if those druids learn to manufacture it themselves, we'll have some good, safer way of administering this apparently delightful drug. I've not tried it. I've never felt it safe.
Wait. Sap is the worst, but you're hoping the druids can make fake sap? That makes zero sense.
I'm hoping a more responsible distributor could be... Apparently it can be used to make men tougher or stronger. And that would be good for fighting men, and that might be good for people who are fighting disease or cold. But the mixture that comes out of the woods now from those sap runners just makes you high and quick and... makes you forget things. It's from what Brother Venamo says, they can make it more reliable. And maybe it will just become something that's as pleasant as a good drink, but maybe it'll be something more.
Why are they executing these people though? That doesn't make any sense.
That I don't know. They've had these kids have been around as long as I've been here.
Their kids?
I don't see why they would... They look so young. They're old, maybe in their 20s, maybe. That's as old as they could be. But
that doesn't
when you see
seem
them,
right.
They look so... look and act so youthful. No, I don't think it's... I don't know. It's not my land. It seems... They've been pinned up in cages as long as Scarlet's had her hands on them.
I see. Well,
I don't know, it doesn't seem right. Let's talk something terrible. What has brought you out here? This is the most dangerous place I can think of in the whole empire.
So of course here I am.
Yeah, I thought you would be in Mustonenfell, knee deep in a book.
What could a book teach me, really? The world doesn't have much more learning about, and with you off doing this, and I decided to seek more thorough application of the things I had learned.
I saw you you come in. I couldn't believe my eyes, actually.
I know, right?
Yeah. So you have a magic floating head?
Well, I mean, sort of. It's not, I mean, you know, it's just a typical, like, carrying spell, right? You know, the invisible servant thing. I have an alchemist that does stuff. You know, alchemists.
Yeah, they're hoot, always doing something stranger.
Yeah.
Where'd you get it?
Oh, well, Did you buy it at the Mustana? You got it in the woods? In the woods, yeah.
On your lonesome, you went into the woods. You took a sacred thing from the woods, and you came back out.
I had the alchemist and some. I had help.
Kaya, that's amazing. I worried that when I left, you wouldn't go back in.
Oh no! Of course, I had to go back in. Are you kidding?
I hoped you would.
Oh, well, you know, Kaya's kind of like starting to really get a little flustered, and compliments are not what she's used to from Sir Jacquard, and I it's nice to see that you approve. It means a lot to me.
Here's what I'd like. Now that you're out here.
Mm-hmm.
Before the end of the week, we're leaving on another expedition. We're going out to some glade where some stone temple is. It's going to be a lot of troops, and it's going to be a dangerous mission. But I would feel safer and happier with you by my side again.
Oh.
Would you come with us?
Well, I have some responsibilities, but that is certainly something that would make me glad as well. Can I get back with you before the end of the week?
I wouldn't rush you. There's time. We'll be making preparations all week.
Okay.
If you need a place to stay, I can make arrangements with Able Public. I'm certain Baron Nyland could also speak for you.
Oh yeah. I'm good for now.
You're good.
For now. Okay. Yeah. You know, noble connection things.
Yes, of course.
I'm
out here on the frontier, it can be, I didn't like the thought of you out in the cold.
Oh.
You know. I appreciate that you want me to stay warm. I'm gonna go now.
It was good seeing you, Kaya.
Yeah.
I understand. Get some rest.
Thanks. Bye.
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 She's gonna back out.
Telepathy coming in. Kaya, have you been flirting?
Excellent. Great.
Walk through the tents in a daze, not paying any attention to whether or not she's being followed, muttering things about Brigetta and why. Streams, and of course she's pregnant again.
Is any of that being broadcast psychically?
How'd it go? Oh my god.
Great.
You have to dish about this mentor? Is that
like
what,
not is coherent, that what you're calling? But you know, the bit about the streams is really, really went through thoroughly.
So where do you guys let's imagine that your communication was great. Where would you paint the scene of how it is that the three of you meet up?
We're going to have to go back to pick up...
Kaya's not paying attention to where she's going, but I bet Isild was kind of coming out, like... It kind of seemed like Isild was on top of things and ready to meet up with people, so maybe Isild finds Reed and then they go find Kaya, because Kaya's kind of just walking in a giant circle, muttering, but she's not saying anything really important. Just muttering.
Reed, there was a list of interesting, fascinating characters at that bar, and you like to drink with people. Was there anyone you would like to be drinking with?
Tall drink of water guy with the pecs.
He was lovely, but he's working right now, and I can't make his job harder. Mm. That would not be polite.
Would you like me to give you a list?
Yeah, refresh me, because I'm just all caught up in creepy-ass druids and hilariously awkward relationships with noble mentors.
People that are at the bar. There is the fighter who is wrestling, the one who stopped the wrestling match from getting violent, who you now know as Crenshaw Wild. There is the acrobat. Is there and is just drinking with people that are around. There is a knight who is drinking, a young knight. There are those three. Olaf, the curious stranger, is there.
I'm less inclined to deal with Olaf now that I know he's posting signs for Scarlet.
Yep, that's true. And Barker.
Oh, Barker! Oh, what was I going to ask Barker? I think Reed would... Barker was helping split up that fight too, right?
Yes.
I think Reed would like to get Barker a drink.
Barker is completely game for a drink. Mm-hmm. But Barker wants something more than a drink. Barker saw the way that you fucking parkour bullshitted around town.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants to challenge you to a gamble. There's a fence that runs along the beer garden.
Yeah.
And he wants to challenge you to a race along that fence. Whoever falls off the least often, the other one buys drinks.
I love that. Reed is totally game for that.
In that case, would you give me a Defy Danger dex in order to not fall on your face?
Is this a Defy Danger caused by movement?
It's a Defy Danger caused by movement.
I have a move for that.
That arguably is showing off.
Oh my goodness. Would this be perhaps something we could say is in pursuit of glory and fame?
Oh yes, because he is gathering a crowd to see the infamous impediment Reed.
Oh, great. Oh, this is wonderful. Reed loves this. Brianna is like, great, more attention. This is gonna go so poorly.
You're welcome.
A roll. So since this is in pursuit of an appetite, that's 1d6 plus 1d8.
And if the d6 is the higher of the pair, trouble happens.
I believe that is correct. And this
that is correct.
So that's a total of plus 2. Well, that's a really shitty roll.
That's a garbage roll.
That's a garbage roll.
That's really bad.
That's a really bad roll.
Is that really what just happened?
That's really what just happened.
1d6 plus 1d8 plus 2, resulting in a 4.
Oh no!
Yeah. Sup, I roll 1s a lot.
Snake eyes.
Sup, you totes roll 1s a lot.
That's, I guess I mark XP.
Lift drink.
Yes, you mark XP. Great job. Congratulations, the first failed roll of the session.
No.
Let's see. I'm looking at my clocks. So, congratulations, you've lost the bet. I'm just seeing if more trouble is going to happen.
Sure. Reed's totally going to play this off as intentionally letting Barker win, since, you know, he's the local big shot, and she actually kind of likes him and wants to be on his good side. And, you know, also she has a sprained ankle.
Would you roll a 1d4 for me?
Oh, God. That's another one.
Okay, this is just fucking insane, but nonetheless, congratulations, you've taken 1 damage from falling and spraining your and slamming into that already injured knee.
Does my armor negate that?
It sure does. You take no damage.
Sweet.
What are you carrying right now?
Gear-wise, I mean, probably my adventuring pack. My adventuring pack would have my rations. I'm wearing the bundle of sticks and feathers wrapped in green cord. That is my trinket from my gang. And my adventuring gear. That's it.
When you fall down, you take your pittance of no damage. You hear something crack in your adventuring pack.
That's no fun.
As you tumble to the ground, it loses a use.
Okay.
What is it that is shattered in your pack?
Oh. That's really hard since I've never thought about what would be in it. Because that's not how it works.
That's not how it works. So what's an unfortunate thing to have broken in your pack?
So adventuring gear is supposed to be mundane but useful stuff?
That's correct. Do you have, like, a flask of oil?
Maybe something like that, or a lantern shelter thing.
Sure. You also have a target lantern in your stuff.
Sure.
You had a target lantern.
Past tense
target lantern, and you didn't realize how badly broken it was until the oil started dripping out the bottom of your pack.
Aww.
And so this is dripping down your nice Croxabore cloak, now just has this sort of kerosene dribble dripping down it.
Oh, I mean, that's all right. It's going to be more waterproof now. It's just going to be more flammable until that dries out. That's great. I'm just going to...
That's no problem. Barker gives this a good and hearty laugh, and you are going to... You are entering into a best 2 out of 3 contest.
Oh, God.
When Isolde and Kaya walk up. And it is... The image here is... This has actually gotten kind of silly. There are many onlookers watching as you're doing this, keeping your wonderful low profile. But in addition, as people walk up, this looks like 2 very large kids running around having fun.
Yeah.
That's the silly thing about this, is that it's like, you guys are doing excellent tightrope walking style, like, mad skills, and many people are impressed by that, but this is also obviously silly.
Yeah, and, like, probably there... I expect there's, like, very childish smack talk involved in this.
Absolutely. There is a... One of the band has stopped playing inside. They're calling it a night. And one of them is now composing a song of, it's an impediment reed pun, but it has to do with you falling down.
Oh, that's great.
Reed, tall as a tree, falls like one, too.
Cute.
And when she curses, it is so blue. These aren't the greatest parts. And that is when you all fall upon... You have all met up. Also, now this means that Barker is involved in this conversation.
Whee! Well, Barker, I seem to run out of time for the evening.
Ah, it's a shame. Lots of good things you can do in an evening.
Yeah. Hopefully there's a lot more good I can do with this one.
Yeah.
You gonna be around later?
Yeah, of course I am. Just ask for my room with Able Public. I'm staying in the Beyond.
That's a fine offer.
It is a fine offer.
I'm trying to remember what Barker's impression when I had previously tried to ask about my gang and their state here when I was trying to ask him about that on the road. Did he seem pro my gang or anti my gang?
He seems to be anti the grand endeavor that is this fortress.
Okay.
And sort of, he is more respectful and more, he has a bigger enmity towards the woods and is more respectful of it, if that makes sense.
Oh, that makes complete sense to me.
He has a bitter hatred of the forest.
It's very, you don't go around wearing the forest as your armor unless it's personal one way or the other.
Correct. His feelings towards the Greenbarks is neither here nor there.
One last thing before I go, Barker. And this is quieter, playing off to the crowd like I'm flirting with him. How do you feel about Scarlet?
Scarlet's a monster, kid. There are worse things. You think there are bad things in those cages. It's what lives in the house that'll eat you.
Yeah, I know that. She's got my family. Depending on how tonight goes, I might not be able to join you at your room later.
You know, check on your family, but don't do anything too rash. If they're locked up, she likes a show. She'll take them out in the open before anything bad happens to them. She's not going to leave them in a cage. She'll leave them in the pit. Funny thing about pits, anybody can get in them.
I hadn't thought about that. I'll think about it. Thanks.
I'll be watching. Good luck.
And then I, meet up with Isolde and Kaya and go, we should probably make it look like we're dispersing into the tents somewhere.
Yeah, if you guys want to immediately break up and meet up with Shim, you can. Don't worry about it. You're competent adventurers.
I wanted to tease Reed some about Barker.
And I'm going to share what Barker said with me about how Scarlet does things.
That could have some advantages. While they apparently tolerate her, I haven't heard a good word about Scarlet. And I'm going to share with them what what Sir Jacquard said about public sentiment might be against her, especially because your gang looks so young.
That does help, usually.
Yeah.
I think that this is probably a fair point to, I don't think I've ever addressed Reed's age. Reed also looks like she must be somewhere in her early 20s. Probably at the oldest.
Youth.
Oh. Okay.
I think that's what we talked about, Trick?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm still trying to, like, she's, if Big Cass from Big Cass and Enzo Amore were portrayed by Wei Zhao, so she's just sort of got that mysterious youth, but is fucking 7 feet tall, and you can't teach that.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Basically.
Mm-hmm.
She's got legs for days.
Okay, after you have an opportunity to compare notes on everything that you've learned this evening, you immediately go to where Shimshackle is expecting to meet you by the menagerie. But before we get to that, we have a bit of end-of-session business to do. As soon as that business is done, we're going to cut straight to the action with Shimshackle and you guys meeting up for a dramatic conclusion. When you reach the end of session, choose one of your bonds that you feel is resolved, completely explored, or no longer relevant or otherwise. Ask the player of the character you have the bond with to see if they agree. If they do, mark XP and write a new bond with whomever you wish. So first, Izzold, have you resolved or significantly changed any of your bonds?
I think so. I think that that Reed is keeping some kind of important secret from me. That's resolved. Because I no longer believe that she's actually keeping any important secret from me. I think that we've grown closer and kind of exposed our emotions to each other and had a vulnerable moment.
Aww.
And now I think I can cross that off and resolve it.
Do you want... What new bond would you like to form? It can be with Reed. It can be with Izzold.
I think there should be...
With... Damn it, Kaya?
We are one.
We are one. With... I think I need a new bond with Reed. So Brianna, tell me if you think it's this would be an okay thing to be a bond. Would be Reed is dedicated to her family, and I will see that they are reunited in some fashion again.
That's really awesome.
Right.
I like it. I will see Reed reunited with her family. I like it. Impediment. What about your bonds?
Well, I think that it continues to be true that Reed thinks that Izzold is remarkably powerful in some terrifying ways, and that she should not be angered. I feel like Kaya has held her own enough... and not really needed protecting, so that bond may be moot now. But I think she has a better respect for Kaya's ability to know when restraint is appropriate.
Would you say that Kaya knows restraint and you could maybe use some?
Yes.
Okay. Kaya, how's that sound to you?
That's fine.
Kaya.
Yes.
How are your bonds? Although, oh, by the way, Bob and Brianna, mark XP.
Oh, yeah.
Hooray!
Well, Reed and I think we have discovered that our humor is not actually as similar as we thought.
Reed does kind of think everything is funny.
Yeah.
So a little less refined taste there.
So while I thought that we would enjoy a lot of good jokes and that was going to be a fun thing that we would do... Turns out, not so much.
Fair. That is, you no longer like to joke with Reed.
No.
Is there another relationship that you have with Reed? How do you feel about this prison break?
Yeah, Reed had been keeping secrets from us, and I think I still trust her, but... I am worried that she's going to make rash decisions that will affect me.
How about, you fear the consequences of Reed's decisions?
Yeah.
and need to guide them.
I fear the consequences of Reed's decisions and need to mitigate them.
Sure.
I am all right with that bond, but I will point out, Reed has given you guys several outs from trying to rescue her gang.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Certainly. And I understand that, but I feel like I have made a commitment to Reed a little bit.
Aww. But
it is kind of like we have very different reactions as to, you know, how we internalize it, but there's no question in either of our minds. Yeah, we're going to help out Reed.
Yeah. Aww. Yeah. Gonna help her out, but I kind of think I'm hoping that we can come up with a plan and not just kind of rashly rush in. So I'm hoping that there might be a plan and not just a let's all run
There's
into
some
the place
time.
with the evil creepy monsters and really weird lady with red hair. So
very well. Mark XP. You've developed as a character, and you get experience from that. Izzel,
yeah.
Have you learned anything about a magical mystery?
Yes, I have. I've learned more about about Herman the Titan and the things that Herman the Titan does. I've also gotten a lead now on this redstone thing, which is very interesting. From an alchemical standpoint. Not quite as interesting as Herman the Titan, because that connects to the secret history of the world. But if we have a chance fighting this scarlet person, I want to find out what this red stone thing is all about.
Very well. Impediment. What about your moral statement, your alignment statement?
Let's see. Eschew a convention of the civilized world. I feel like yes, but I can't quite put my finger on which of my many acts are more,
This also covers last session,
childish
and, so
and barbaric.
You've covered that. You didn't bow. You did terrible all around Baron Nyland.
Look, yeah. She's just another person.
Yeah.
Look, I'm just stunned you didn't footsie with Anza.
There was a great deal of temptation, but too busy stuffing my face.
Uh-huh. Mark XP, Kaya, what about your alignment statement?
Helping an animal or spirit of the wild. Trying to remember if anything happened last session that would have done that.
You didn't really help Angus, because the magic for Breeze was Izzold's doing.
But I did make sure he had the bed.
I wonder if your... This'll be a little inside baseball, but you're keeping the head, not handing over the head, is helping a spirit
yes,
of the wild.
Certainly, yes. I am very determined to, yes, that, yeah, I'll agree with that.
For the time being, that'll be the definition we'll use for that one, is that action continues to be something that helps it.
For the moment, perhaps. It is certainly my intent that it is helping it. And that should count for something with alignment.
Did we learn something new and important about the world?
Yeah.
Yes, Mark XP. Did we overcome a notable monster or enemy?
No.
No, I don't think so. We'll get plenty of that next session.
Oh dear. Oh dear.
Oh yeah.
And did we loot a memorable treasure?
No.
I don't think you have a new cool thing.
Nah,
right
I just
now.
Got this
no.
mead. It's pretty cool, but, you know.
I don't think Barker's good opinion counts.
No, that's very valuable and can take you
but,
places.
But it's not a
not a treasure.
Physical treasure.
Not looting a memorable treasure. Now that our end of session business is completed, it's time for all of us to catch up with Shimshackle by the Menagerie. As you approach that wall, you can hear, you remembered that growl, that brass trumpet sound that the forest would make when it was angry. And as you walk along that wall, you can hear that sound resonating from something beyond it, something within the menagerie. And you almost feel like it's also being emanated, like it echoes through the woods the walkwood wall of this fortress whenever you hear that sound. And Shimshackle, he's kneeling by the wall waiting for you, and he looks terrified. What do you do? There's a tall wooden fortress wall next to you. You're out inside the brush on the edge of the city, and you can hear these sounds from the inside of the menagerie.
Well, I was kind of expecting them, given Edvard's description. So I kind of list them, look at Shimshackle. Is this different from what you were expecting?
I wanted to look in on the gang. Just take a peek, a little peek. Uh-huh. She'd been keeping them on display in a cage just at the edge of her pit, but they're not there anymore. I don't know where they are in there. They're usually outside, but I doubt she'd keep them in her house. If she's keeping them, she's keeping them in the animal pens.
Oof.
Great.
Baron Nyland did tell us to mark well the gate, as well as a side house.
Yeah, I know where that is. That's, she has a manor house that backs up to the wall next to the ditch by the motte. But the wall just hits the side of the manor house. The back of the manor house is out over the ditch.
The back of the house. Another detail that may or may not change the situation. Brother Venamo is aware that something horrible is going to happen to the Greenbark gang tomorrow if we don't do anything. He doesn't know about my involvement, or indeed our involvement, but he did seem concerned about the safety of the Greenbark gang.
That guy. Don't go. Don't trust that guy. He's a bloodsucker, that one.
I did hear that he held you, Greenbarks, for a while before you were remitted over to Scarlet.
Yeah, he says our blood is different. He's a bloodsucker, that one.
Oh god, you mean that
literally. Oh wow.
Yeah, he says we're special. Something about the sap being in us. He doesn't want any of the Greenbarks getting away, or at least not all of them. He wants us for parts.
That's really creepy.
That's really creepy.
That's fascinating.
Thank you once again for listening to the Crooked Thimble as we play Iron Immortals. Join us next week for what may be the final episode of The Shattering at Harris Rekha. Even if our heroes aren't run out of town, I assure you that Harris Rekha and the Empire will never be the same again. 7 Days a Servant, my novel set in the Iron Immortals world, is available now on Inkshares. Head over there, order a copy, and recommend the page. Our music this week was composed by Sergei Teremzinov. You may find links to his work in the show notes. Please do share this podcast with whatever means you have available. And remember that the Crooked Thimble is a Patreon-funded company. If you want to hear more of these adventures, please head on over to patreon.com/crookedthimble and support us. And, as always, thank you.